This is the story about a dream, one that started way back in the 1970s. By the latter part of that decade, Doctor Who had become more than just a Saturday night television fixture. With the boggle-eyed Tom Baker in the lead role, and after over a decade of adventures in space and time, it had become a hallowed institution. Up and down the British Isles and beyond, young boys and girls were reenacting their heroes' escapades, or creating new ones as they dashed about their school playgrounds and back gardens, swathed in multicoloured scarves knitted for them by their doting grannies. One such boy, one amongst all the millions, sat in his customary place before the family television after a weekend of defeating imaginary monsters and watched as the curly-haired Bohemian fought off another group of foes intent on the destruction of all we hold dear. He wasn't frightened. If anything, he wanted the monsters to be more terrifying, for all the greater would be the Time Lord's victory. And so, this little boy, like all the other millions, gasped and smiled and was thrilled by the Doctor's adventures, and dreamed, as they all did, that one day, maybe, just maybe, he could be the Doctor too. Those dreams faded as the children grew up, blown away by the winds of time and misfortune and opportunities missed, except for that one little boy. For him, that dream, the dream, came true.
It's a kind of TV time travel trying to bring back an old hit. Have they made it work?
Well, I very much think they have. I mean, I go right back to the William Hartnell days of Doctor Who when it was black and white and I was hiding behind the sofa when the Cybermen came out.
In 2005, the TARDIS triumphantly returned to our screens, very quickly silencing naysayers and TV executives alike who had long written Doctor Who off as an embarrassing relic of a less sophisticated time.
And what about the rest of the series? Are you pleased?
I'm delighted. I could not be more delighted with it.
Under the enthusiastic and careful stewardship of producers Russell T. Davis, Phil Collinson and Julie Gardner, with the wise support of Mal Young and Jane Tranter, the series had been successfully resurrected to great acclaim and definitively proved that Saturday night was not dead after all, that there was, in fact, a desire for a show that all the family could watch and enjoy together. Playgrounds and back gardens could once more play host to imaginary escapades where the Doctor and his brave companion fought off the evil machinations of gas mask zombies asking for their mummies,
I am my mummy,
farting Raxacoracophalopatorians, and of course, the dreaded Daleks.
Exterminate!
Viewers can be forgiven for wondering whether such success could last as that first series drew to a close, however, with the leak of Christopher Eccleston's leaving of the show resulting in the usual sensationalist headlines in so-called newspapers that made their money from gossip and tittle-tattle, it would seem that not all was smooth sailing at the show's production office in Cardiff. Despite the salacious rumours circulating as to Eccleston's decision to depart, the show's future was secure, at least for another year. Following the phenomenal success of the debut episode, Rose, the BBC quickly commissioned a second series with a Christmas special to bridge the gap. With the eventual scheduling of this special at the coveted peak time Christmas Day slot, Davis couldn't have been more honoured, and is a testament to just how important the corporation now viewed a show that for so long they had written off or outright derided. We, the fans, finally felt vindicated, and it was quite something to hear young children openly talking about the return of classic monsters with unashamed excitement, something that for so long had been drilled into us as sad or pathetic.
Have you got a favourite monster? Apart from me, obviously.
It will probably be the Empty Child from episodes 9 and 10.
Is that your favourite episode, or was that your favourite alien?
Probably my favourite alien. My favourite episode is probably episodes 12 and 13.
The Parting of the Ways.
Yeah, and Bad Wolf. Because it's just basically the end of the world.
Davis had actually done what we'd all hoped for, but never truly believed possible. It made everyone see how amazing the show could be, how exciting, how life-affirming, how wonderfully scary. He'd made Doctor Who cool again. But now, the pressure must have been immense. Like a breakout band composing their second album, Davis and his team had to face the prospect of doing it all again, but even better, with their central star no longer present. Many weren't sure they could pull it off. After all, the reconfiguration of the central hero from what had been arguably a dusty academic, an upper-middle-class establishment figure, into the working-class, no-nonsense, leather-jacketed breath of fresh air that was Eccleston's take on the role, was seen as one of the central pillars of the revival's success. With the star now moving on, many would be willing to step into his chunky boots, but who would be able? We mustn't forget, however, that Davis is a Doctor Who fan, and had been all his life. He knew it could work because he'd seen it done 8 times before, and knew that such upheavals were ingrained in the very DNA of his favourite programme. Davis, like many true creatives, saw the potential possibility such an unexpected turn of events offered, and his familiarity with the show of which he was the current custodian meant that he knew that if he made the right choices, avoided the mistakes of past years, it could be truly fantastic.
It was very scary because we had got one of the best actors in the land and you don't want the programme to take a step down.
The real trick was to get the right person for the job and use that person's unique take on the character to help craft future developments in the narrative.
Chris set the bar as high as it could possibly be, and then in regenerating the Doctor you need to find an actor who's every bit as good.
Eccleston's impending exit was known by the production team from at least January of 2005, meaning that they had some time to prepare for the handover to a new Doctor by the time production was planned to finish in March, but not much. Fortunately, there was one actor who, it could be argued, had been waiting in the wings for the chance to fly the TARDIS his whole life. Born the day after Episode 2 of Colony in Space was transmitted in 1971, David MacDonald was raised in Paisley, a town just west of Glasgow in Scotland. After seeing Pertwee's finale, Planet of the Spiders, he became an ardent Doctor Who fan, tuning in to his hero's escapades with a fervour approaching religious. He only missed a single episode in 9 years, unwillingly dragged away for a family visit, something he couldn't quite forgive his parents for. It was while watching Doctor Who, wrapped in the multicoloured scarf his gran had knitted for him, that it occurred to the young Scot that the stories he was enjoying, the fantastical adventures that transported him weekly, were actually made by someone. This realisation solidified his destiny. He would become an actor, and one day, he would become the Doctor.
Till we meet again, Sarah.
His obsession with the show never really abated, and by the 80s, now sporting a cricket jumper again knitted by his gran, he was working in references to the show in essays he wrote at Paisley Grammar School, the most famous titled Intergalactic Overdose, where he showed a wry sense of humour and a mature self-awareness of his habit. Fortunately, he had a loving family who supported him and his ambitions despite advising him to study teaching so that he would have something to fall back on if his acting aspirations didn't materialise. The young man was committed to his dream, however, and won a place at the Royal Scottish Academy of Music and Drama when he was 17. The actors' union, Equity, already had a member named David MacDonald, so the young actor was forced to adopt a stage name, settling on Tennant after reading an article about Neil Tennant, frontman of the Pet Shop Boys in pop magazine Smash Hits. By the time he graduated in 1991, Doctor Who was seemingly dead, but his desire for the stage and screen was as fierce as ever. After cutting his teeth in touring theatre and some bit parts in television, his first major role came when he appeared in the 6-part BBC Scotland drama Taking Over the Asylum, playing the part of Campbell Bain, one of the contributors to a hospital radio station established at the fictional St Jude's Asylum.
You're going to be proud of me, Dad. Because I've decided that my future, my life's work, my soul's passion is going to be this.
You're going to be an airline pilot?
No. A radio disc jockey. And I can get all the experience I need right here on the hospital station.
Back to that, are we?
Back to what?
Well, 6 months ago you wanted to be a pop star.
Well, it was different. I can't sing.
2 years before, you wanted to be a racing jockey.
I'm afraid of horses.
Before that, you wanted to be an actor.
I can't remember lines, but this is different. I'm good at it. I know I am.
Ah, well, there's a lot of things are going to be different from now on. Your mother and me have been talking, and we've decided it would be a good idea if you went to your Auntie Susan's for a bit.
But she lives in Perth.
Yes, but you can go to adult classes there. You'll get the peace and quiet that you need.
I can't go to Perth. I've got to stay in Glasgow to work in the station. I need the experience.
You need to get well.
But I'm not ill. You can't make me go to Perth. I'm 19 years old, and I'm staying in Glasgow to work in the station. I'm going to be a professional DJ, whether you like it or not.
You stand there, shouting at the top of your voice, throwing your arms about like some mad scarecrow, and you're telling me you're not ill? You're not capable of thinking straight. and some straight thinking needs to be done. Now, your mother and me have done our best to look after you. If that's not good enough for you, then there's nothing left but to have you sectioned and let the doctors decide.
My Jesus.
The show went on to win awards for its exploration of mental health issues, and Tennant was recognised as a rising talent for his sensitive portrayal of Campbell, a sufferer of bipolar disorder. Moving to London shortly after, Tennant secured roles with the Royal Shakespeare Company and performed at the National Theatre while steadily adding further television and film appearances to his CV. He even appeared alongside future Ninth Doctor actor Christopher Eccleston in a small part in the leading man's 1996 film, Jude. It looked as though that dream of being in Doctor Who might never appear as the new millennium approached. This didn't stop Tennant from dipping his toes into the franchise where possible, as he appeared in several Big Finish audios, including an important role in Nicholas Briggs' spin-off series Dalek Empire, and demonstrating his range in playing Daft Jamie in a Sixth Doctor adventure involving 19th century grave robbers Burke and Hare.
No one can shout, no one can shout, no one can shout when the doctor's about. No one can shout, no one can shout. No, Mary, stop shouting. The doctor won't like you if you shout, Mary. Mary. More blood, Mary. Why more blood, Mary? Mary? Mary! Mary!
As mentioned in the previous episode, he also managed to catch a few lines in the aborted animated web series revival of the show, Scream of the Shalker. It was around this time that Tennant's rising star crossed paths with that of Russell T Davies's own, as the latter was convinced to bring to BBC Wales a drama he was developing about 18th century Lothario Giacomo Casanova. For the lead part, the production team knew they needed someone who could believably portray the legendary lover, but also be convincing as a younger version of the great Peter O'Toole, who was cast as the character's older self. They found their leading man in Tennant, and through conversation between the writer and actor, it became apparent that they shared a passion for Doctor Who. Fortunately for Tennant, Russell T Davies had simultaneously been given the task of reviving that very show. When the actor discovered this fact, he begged Davies for a part. Little did he know of the changes afoot as Series 1 went before the cameras. During transmission of the musical crime drama Blackpool in late 2004, in which Tennant played a detective investigating a murder, Stephen Moffat had sent a text to Doctor Who's showrunner saying that he'd just seen the 10th Doctor. His prophecy came true early the following year, when executive producer Julie Gardner offered Tennant the role he'd dreamed of since those days running around his garden in his grand-knitted scarf.
I didn't get a call about the part. I was sitting with Russell T Davies and Julie Gardner at the time, and they just sort of brought it up.
I was dying to be the one to ask him, and Julie actually came in with it and said it. It's like, damn, I wanted to be the one.
It was a fairly surreal moment, and I just laughed, really.
He just burst out laughing. He literally gave the big, threw his head back and gave the biggest laugh.
It just felt like a fairly impossible prospect. It was very exciting.
It may be surprising to learn that he didn't automatically accept. Taken aback by the strangeness of the up-to-now incorporeal fantasy suddenly becoming solid reality, Tennant laughed and swore and hesitated. Was he the one, after all, who could inhabit the shoes of the intergalactic wanderer, the hero of a thousand worlds and countless histories? Would he, undoubtedly the next big thing, but nevertheless an actor of limited experience compared to his forebears, be able to take on the mantle from such a heavyweight like Chris Eccleston? Davies understood, and allowed Tennant to take some time to consider it. Tennant left the meeting, and spent the next few days doing just that. The dream was finally within his grasp. All his life had built to this moment, from his decision to become an actor to his dedication to achieving this goal in the face of so many rational, sensible arguments against pursuing it. The opportunity wouldn't come again, and he was keenly aware of how momentous it would be for his life, career, and future. How could he possibly ever forgive himself for not seizing the offer with both hands? If nothing else, he thought, it would ensure the first line of his obituary would be written in advance. Getting in touch with the producers, he of course excitedly accepted. Tennant had yet to be formally contracted when Eccleston's Regeneration was filmed on Friday, the 4th of March 2005, meaning that the handover between actors didn't occur in the way it had traditionally done over the years. Tennant, accompanied by a skeleton crew, shot his half of the sequence the following month, with gaffer tape standing in for Billy Piper to provide the new Doctor with an eyeline. According to producer Tracy Simpson, who introduced Tennant to what was to become his console room, the young actor jumped for joy and was close to tears at the dream finally being realised. Before this, however, disaster very nearly struck the production when, at the end of March, press rumours began circulating due to an unidentified leak that Eccleston was departing and that the team were in talks with Tennant to take over. Not only was this a blow for the entertainment value, as Davis had hoped to keep the regeneration secret right up to transmission, but very nearly affected the casting of Tennant at a critical time when negotiations with his agent were ongoing. As a result, the big surprise was ruined, and the BBC were forced to announce Tennant's casting at midnight on the 15th of April, merely confirming the rumours and online gossip, and not wanting the news to overshadow Eccleston's run, which was only three episodes in by that point. Tennant has always felt this a shame, as he never got to be triumphantly revealed as the new Doctor. Rather, the hurried nature of the press release gave the move an air of desperation, as if Eccleston's departure had thrown a major spanner in the works, and the team had hastily scrambled to fill the role.
Christopher Eccleston said, "Because it's really difficult watching a programme in your youth and then becoming the person that you watched on the telly. You know, there's something that is quite hard to reconcile. That you have a big responsibility and a big duty, really, don't you?
You do, and you kind of can't really think about it. When you have little objective moments, when you realise that you're part of the same thing,
yes,
it all becomes a bit overwhelming. Yeah. So I try not to think about that too much.
Being a long-term fan of the programme, it was never going to be just another role for him. The pressure and weight of responsibility on his shoulders was immense. Following the leak, he couldn't quite resist his curiosity to discover what the fandom was saying about him, and found himself checking out the forums on leading Doctor Who website Outpost Gallifrey. At first, he was pleased to see some flattering, positive posts about the news. That was before he scrolled down a little further and saw comments like, "I can't bear the sight of him. I'd rather have David Morrissey," and simply, "Who?" The last one he came across read, "That's it. The dream is finished. Somebody who looks like a weasel could never play the Doctor. It's over." To his credit, Tennant was undaunted, deciding that it might be best to avoid such anti-social media in future.
"Before I go, I just want to tell you, you were fantastic."
With the casting of the 10th Doctor secured, decisions needed to be made by both head writer and actor as to the character of this new incarnation. It would be 5 months between the end of Series 1 and the Christmas special where the 10th Doctor would truly be unveiled, and the final minute of Episode 13, the audience's first glimpse of the next incarnation, was critical in engaging their commitment to return. At first, these discussions were limited to superficial aspects, befitting the brevity of his introduction. Sideburns, slightly scruffy hair, and a sense of grinning optimism to contrast with what had been the slightly more morose 9th incarnation.
"Hello. Okay."
The biggest decision involved the new Doctor's accent.
"New teeth. That's weird. So where was I? Oh, that's right. Barcelona."
Tennant's native Scottish was eschewed by Davis and Gardner in favour of the estuary English one he had used for the aforementioned Casanova. Apparently, there was a line cut from his debut where it was suggested that his new accent had been picked up from companion Rose, imprinted on him as his new body and personality formed. From a production point of view, perhaps the decision reflected a desire to contrast with the so-called regional one of his predecessor. Whatever the reason, this made Tennant the first actor cast as the Doctor not to use his native accent. After his brief appearance in the closing minutes of Series 1 was completed, the real work of developing the 10th Doctor began. One of Tennant's first requests on landing the part was that his Doctor wear a long coat, the long-term fan knowing that such attire would prove handy for location work and also afford him much opportunity to indulge in lots of pocket acting, something that the actor felt helped with his performances. In consultation with Davis, incoming costume designer Louise Page worked closely with the new lead in developing what would become the 10th Doctor's iconic look. Tennant's wish for a long coat was granted in the form of an ankle-length double-breasted brown duster made from upholstery fabric. Under this, the decision to have the new Doctor appear somewhat like a scruffy student, but also to recall somewhat the formality of earlier incarnations, led to the design of a brown pinstripe suit and tie cut in a way reminiscent of the 1930s without being period-specific. The suit material was in fact sourced from several pairs of trousers to ensure that the fabric would be thin enough to give the slightly crumpled, old-fashioned look Tennant and Davis were keen for the new Doctor to have. Having originally planned for the lead to sport a pair of Japanese army boots, Page conceded to Tennant's demand to instead wear Converse trainers or sand shoes, taking inspiration from the legendary singer-songwriter Paul McCartney, who was somewhat famous for wearing a similar ensemble. It would also, Tennant hoped, offer young people an easy opportunity to dress as the Doctor themselves. Topping the whole get-up was a pair of tortoiseshell-rimmed square glasses, handy for moments of intense examination of curious items and for dramatically whipping them off in moments of action. With these small flourishes, the lead character both recalled the scholarliness of past incarnations and firmly slotted into the emergent fashion across clothing and entertainment media, that of geek chic. When Tennant attended his first photo call in costume on the 25th of July, mere hours before recording his first scenes for the Christmas special, he was instantly recognisable, both as conforming to the traditional silhouette of the fundamentally British television hero, and as an embodiment of the zeitgeist of the early 21st century. With the growing popularity of science fiction and comic books, the fandom of which no longer being a shameful, guilty pleasure, the geeks were inheriting the Earth, and this skinny, scruffy outsider figure suddenly became, somewhat unexpectedly, sexy. Indeed, any true consideration of the Tennant era cannot ignore how his casting and the development of the series' narrative attracted and encouraged an appreciation of the character that hadn't really been an avenue of fandom before. The combination of Doctor Who's resurgent popularity, Tennant's casting, and the development of active social media usage by so-called tweens, seemingly obsessed by the burgeoning romance between the Doctor and his audience identification figure companion, was a perfect storm that arguably led to a whole new demographic taking the show to their hearts, a different but no less passionate appreciation of the programme than the one the rest of us had harboured for so many years. To this day, the 10th Doctor, and particularly his first series with Rose Tyler by his side, holds a special place in that pantheon of programmes devoured by young people in their formative teenage years, especially girls, who imagine and express their love and obsession with a fervour some find bemusing or even embarrassing. Us old hands shouldn't feel this way, though. Rather, we should recognise such passion as not too dissimilar to our own. After all, spending hours drawing Rose and her Doctor with kawaii aesthetics is not a million miles removed from lovingly crafting red question marks on sticky labels before cutting them out and applying them to the collar of one's school shirt. Moving swiftly on. As is tradition, however, we wouldn't see the new Doctor garbed in his own distinct style, nor truly settled into his new persona straight away.
Now, let's check in at the Children in Need Nerve Centre atop the BT Tower. Can you hear me, Mother? Can you hear me, Chris Moyle?
The opportunity arose during production of Series 2 for the 10th Doctor to make a swift debut in a short film shown as part of the BBC's annual Children in Need charity telethon in November of 2005, just a few days before the programme's 42nd anniversary.
6 p.m. Tuesday, October 5006. On the way to Barcelona. Alan.
What do I look like?
With the suggestion from Julie Gardner of setting the short in between the closing scenes of Series 1 and the opening of the already filmed Christmas special, Davis was keen to have it be canonical, vetoing any of the corporation's ideas to include references to the charity appeal, such as having Children in Need mascot Pudsey Bear sitting on the console.
A little bit thinner, that's weird. Give me time, I'll get used to it.
The resultant film is an intriguing and tantalising glimpse into the adventures ahead, and a clear sign that the relationship between the lead and his companion would continue to be centre stage in the new series.
Go on then, tell me. What do you mean?
Who are you?
I'm the Doctor.
No. Where is he? Where's the Doctor? What have you done to him?
You saw me, I changed. Right in front of you.
I saw him sort of explode and then you replaced him like a teleport or a transnet or a body swap or something. You're not fooling me.
It does somewhat suffer from the need to not really upset the status quo needed for the forthcoming and already recorded Christmas adventure, but we were granted a quick introduction to a more manic and less stable incarnation, albeit one suffering from the after effects of his traumatic regeneration.
Oh, come on, all I did was change. I didn't...
What?
I said... Uh-oh.
Change is going a bit wrong. I'm all...
Look, maybe we should go back. Let's go and find Captain Jack. He'd know what to do.
Ah, he's busy. He's got plenty to do rebuilding the Earth. I haven't used this one in years.
The strong audience figures for Children in Need helped to build the hype and expectation for the new Doctor's full debut the following month, and on Christmas Day, 9.8 million viewers settled down in front of the television for the first episode to be transmitted on the 25th of December since 1965's The Feast of Stephen.
Celebrate?
Yes.
whereas that had been a throwaway installment in the epic 12-part Daleks Masterplan story with slapstick shenanigans and a bizarre direct audience address by William Hartnell as the First Doctor.
Incidentally, happy Christmas to all of you at home!
2005's The Christmas Invasion was arguably the most important story of the show's 21st century return, more so than Series 1 opener Rose, as it had to prove that the new series' success wasn't just a flash in the pan, and that the modern audience could accept the concept of regeneration, something pretty much unique to Doctor Who.
Here we are then. London! Earth! Solar system, isn't it? Jackie! Mickey! Blimey!
No!
Hold on. Wait there. I was going to say. There's something I have to tell you. Something important. What was it? No, hold on. Shh. Oh! I know! Merry Christmas!
This is where the character development of Rose and her family throughout the preceding episodes paid dividends. After a brief introduction of a new doctor afflicted by the stresses of post-regenerative trauma, Davis carefully chooses to focus on these characters rather than the new doctor, anchoring the drama around Rose's difficulties accepting the change to her beloved friend and hero, and reintroducing the domesticity that had proved so effective engaging new viewers just months previously.
Thing is, I thought I knew him, Mum. I thought me and him were. And then he goes and does this. I keep forgetting he's not human.
Perhaps lifting ideas from Third Doctor debut Spearhead from Space once more, Davis chooses to have the Doctor incapacitated for the most part, leaving Rose, Mickey and Jackie to face the growing threat of the Sycorax invasion alone. Unlike that earlier story, however, the lack of focus on the Doctor serves a greater function, illustrating how dire the stakes become by his absence, and despite the best efforts of the competent and courageous people whom he has influenced. It's to Davis's credit as a great character creator that all the pieces neatly fall into place from earlier stories, with likeable characters such as Penelope Wilton's Harriet Jones, now Prime Minister, taking the leadership reins.
I'm getting demands from Washington, Mark. The President is insisting that he take control of the situation.
You can tell the President, and please use these exact words. He's not my boss, and he's certainly not turning this into a war.
And Noel Clarke's Mickey, now far less pathetic than his earlier appearances, stepping in to share some of the action with Billy Piper's Rose. Still, as their efforts increasingly fall flat in the face of the seemingly unstoppable belligerence of the warrior Sycorax, the audience are whipped up to an edge-of-the-seat tension, a full 39 minutes into the hour-long special before the Doctor finally emerges from the TARDIS, revived by that most quintessentially British restorative, tea, resplendent in full Arthur Dent get-up to ask...
Did you miss me?
Yes, Doctor, we did. What follows is a bravura performance from Tennant, deftly encapsulating the full range of his incarnation's personality.
Just can't get the star. Now you, just wait. I'm busy.
Facetious in the face of danger, friendly and frivolous.
Mickey, hello!
Flirtatious.
Am I funny? Am I sarcastic? Sexy?
Seemingly scatterbrained.
Life and soul. Right-handed, left-handed, a gambler, a fighter, a coward, a traitor, a liar, a nervous wreck. I mean, judging by the evidence, I've certainly got a goal.
Pop culture referencing.
Look at these people, these human beings. Consider their potential. From the day they arrive on the planet and blinking step into the sun, there is more to see than can ever be seen. More to do than... No, hold on. Sorry, that's the Lion King.
With a childlike enthusiasm.
So if I see a great big threatening button which should never ever ever be pressed, then I just want to do this.
But nevertheless, having a lack of patience for immoral and unjust actions.
What is that? What's happening?
That was murder. That was defense.
And an underlying arrogance and self-appointed moral guardianship the most pronounced and black and white since McCoy's seventh incarnation.
And I should have stopped you. What does that make you, Doctor? Another alien threat?
Don't challenge me, Harriet Jones, because I'm a completely new man.
I could bring down your government with a single word.
This last character trait, the 10th Doctor's hamartia, would come back to haunt his incarnation in later stories. Taking its place as the second most watched programme of the day on British television, just behind eternally popular soapy Extenders, and with an audience appreciation index score of 84%, The Christmas Invasion firmly cemented the status of Doctor Who as a successfully revived British institution.
It's all waiting out there, Jackie. And it's brand new to me. All those planets, creatures and horizons, I haven't seen them yet. Not with these eyes. And it is gonna be fantastic.
Andy, your stick gives me the creeps.
Forces of evil amassing against the Doctor. It's time to escape in the TARDIS.
As Series 2 began in April 2006, the show began to enjoy a popularity and prominence it had not enjoyed since at least the early 80s, and perhaps before.
Doctor Who action figures and TARDIS playset.
From character.
Doctor Who was everywhere, and it was with a sense of vindication and pride that I overheard young people discussing the merits of Daleks versus Cybermen, and watched as shop shelves filled up with action figures, books, pencil cases, lunchboxes, and sonic screwdriver toys. Alongside the television episodes, the series made efforts towards media saturation with an interactive instalment accessible via the BBC's Red Button service.
Use your remote to activate the different controls quickly when I tell you.
60-second TARDISodes that acted as introductions to the transmitted stories. Animated adventures.
Balthazar is after the Infinite, the legendary starship that has the power to create your heart's desire.
Celebrations of the series' music at the annual proms. And a new magazine aimed at younger fans, Doctor Who Adventures, which included exciting free gifts with every issue. Now the show had become cool again, it began to embrace its long history more overtly, reintroducing fan favourite former companion Sarah Jane Smith.
Hello, Sarah Jane.
It's you. Oh, Doctor. Oh my God, it's you, isn't it?
And actually making me enjoy the resurrection of K-9.
Forget the shooty dog thing.
Like the Daleks of the previous series, the Cybermen were reintroduced with a modern spin to make them more chillingly relevant to an age now used to mass communication and digital data. Having been initially sceptical of how alien worlds might put new viewers off, and therefore restricting the stories of Series 1 for the most part to Earth, Davis and the production team finally took the step of taking the TARDIS beyond our planet and its immediate vicinity with some wonderfully traditional quarry work, illustrating just how far the BBC had come since the 80s in representing an alien environment.
Well, this should help. Gravity globe.
All of this, however, rather than merely cashing in or recycling established continuity, was underpinned by Davis's characteristic focus on character and emotional resonance, ensuring that the explosive action and monstrous manoeuvres of the villains was window dressing to the real secret of the new series' success, the relationship between the Doctor and his companion, the human story being explored at the heart of the science fiction shenanigans.
I've had a life with you for 19 years. But then I met the Doctor. And all the things I've seen him do for me, for you, for all of us, for the whole stupid planet and every planet out there, he does it alone, Mum. But not anymore. Because now he's got me.
Indeed, it is this arc that is really the core of Series 2. Never mind the references and asides to Torchwood, the real climax being built to over these 13 episodes is the inevitable tragedy of Rose being separated from her Doctor after so much unrequited romance.
Systems closed.
It stopped working. He did it. He closed the breach.
No.
For many, the seeming finality of their separation, combined with Murray Gold's musical lament, and that final interrupted confession promises fresh tears at every rewatch.
I love you.
It's quite right. And I suppose it's my last chance to say it. Rose Tyler.
For myself, whilst I found Rose's departure moving, I was more excited to see where the show would go next, familiar as I was with the debut and departure of many companions and even doctors over the years. I must admit, I found their relationship in Series 2 a little tedious, and their twee interactions in the face of danger a little undercutting of the stakes and drama.
Who are you gonna call?
Ghostbusters!
I ain't afraid of no ghosts.
That I am not amused.
Yes!
Not remotely. Amused.
One could argue in retrospect, of course, that this very thoughtless gallivanting is what leads to their eventual separation, their flippant frivolity provoking the fearful ire of Queen Victoria into establishing the very organisation who would directly contribute to their riven relationship.
I don't know what you are, the two of you, or where you're from, but I know that you consort with stars and magic and think it fun, but your world is steeped in terror and blasphemy and death, and I will not allow it.
But this doesn't change the fact that it is at times like being the unfortunate singleton sitting across the table from a couple in the early throes of a nauseating romance.
Oh my God, they're werewolves!
I can understand why people were and still are so invested in their relationship, however, and respect that this great chameleon of a narrative can take its place in that pantheon of tragic romance stories, but I feel that this obsession with Rose only produced diminishing returns, as she was then continually name-checked and moped over by the Doctor.
Still. Gone now. Not that you're replacing her.
You never said I was.
Just one trip. To say thanks, you get one trip, then back home.
Before her inevitable return undercut the emotional weight of that original departure.
Right, now we're in trouble. It's only just beginning.
So where are we going?
Further than we've ever gone before.
Series 2 proved to be even more successful than the first, as Tennant was embraced with a popularity no Doctor had really enjoyed since the mighty Tom Baker. The energy and ebullience of the Saturday night show once more indicated the way forward to a national television industry that had played it safe for far too long. Suddenly, shows were springing up all over the place, aiming to capitalise on an audience long thought to have ceased to exist. ITV offered a rival in the form of Primeval, which never quite enjoyed similar success due to a less broad premise, but aiming for comparable energy, youthfulness, and special effects extravaganza.
Please, help me!
I have.
The BBC went on to commission Merlin in 2008, which acted as a winter equivalent for Doctor Who's audience, and with many of that show's production team involved, serving up a weekly dose of Arthurian legend-inspired excitement and adventure.
Sir Lancelot, Knight of Camelot.
The possibilities promised by the success of Doctor Who also began to have a far wider knock-on effect, however, with commissioners now convinced to invest in shows that included more supernatural or offbeat ideas, even if not aimed at children. Whilst it's difficult to definitively trace the direct influence of Doctor Who's success, I don't think it a coincidence that shows like Life on Mars, Being Human, and Misfits all went into production in the months and years that followed its successful return. Most pertinent, however, was the commission of spin-off shows from the main series. After being offered Doctor Who as a pet project to sweeten the offer to come and work for BBC Wales, Davis must have felt like a kid in a candy shop when encouraged to develop further programmes for specific audiences. The first, alluded to throughout Series 2 to lay a foundation of interest in the minds of the audience, was Torchwood. Taking its title from the pseudonymous moniker for some episodes during the production of Series 1, being an anagram of Doctor Who used to avoid spoilers and leaks, the first spin-off was envisaged as a post-Watershed science fiction show for the BBC's younger adult audience-orientated third channel, with former companion Captain Jack Harkness as the lead, alongside Eve Miles as Gwen Cooper, a distant relative of Miles' character Gwyneth of Series 1. Torchwood immediately set out its stall as a more violent and explicit drama in the universe of Doctor Who, with gore and sexual content either depicted or alluded to from the off.
Bloody hell, that is brilliant. That's like, Hellraiser.
That's first class, that is.
Look at that. That is just like real teeth, honest.
Despite this, however, it would be misleading to conclude that the series was more mature. In fact, I always found it, especially its first series, rather immature, with a sort of adolescent gratuity frequently levelled at the new adventures novels of the 90s as one of its primary problems.
Right, sorry, just to recap, you've travelled here to feed off orgasmic energy.
There's nothing else out there like it.
Whilst it's true that the show eventually ironed out some of its inconsistencies, with its second series enjoying a more consistent tone, it never rose to the heights of truly being worthy of a lasting longevity in its own right.
Excuse me, have you seen a blowfish driving a sports car? Thank you.
Bloody Torchwood.
This may be partly due to the fact that the series was littered with references and reliance on the main series, the Doctor's severed hand from his debut not really serving much of a narrative function beyond teasing an eventual reunion of Jack and the Doctor in Series 3, and the inevitable inclusion of the Torchwood team in the finale of Series 4, but more on that later.
It's totally Doctor Who.
At the other end of the audience spectrum, young children were catered for with Totally Doctor Who, a Blue Peter-like magazine show themed exclusively around the programme, with guest interviews, behind-the-scenes featurettes and competitions encouraging young people to write in to win prizes, or even design new monsters for inclusion in the show. Totally Doctor Who came to an end when a further spin-off drama was commissioned aimed at its demographic, the Sarah Jane Adventures. After Children's BBC had suggested a show that would centre around the adventures of a young Doctor, Davis wisely vetoed the idea and offered instead a series following the exploits of that most popular of past companions, Sarah Jane Smith. A similar series starring Elizabeth Sladen and John Leeson as Canine had been aborted in the early 80s, with only a pilot episode ever produced, but Davis knew that the potential of the premise had some merit and had successfully reintroduced the character in Series 2's school reunion. Sladen's intrepid investigative journalist Sarah Jane was a perfect fit for a show aimed at and starring young people learning moral values and independence.
Taking life is never the answer, General Kudlak, whether we've been wronged by one man or a whole planet. It's always the innocents that suffer.
In my opinion, the show was far more effective from the off in living up to its potential, perhaps because of the long history of quality children's television produced by the BBC and others over the years prior to its debut, providing a strong foundation and wealth of experience to draw on in realising the adventures.
When I was your age, I used to think, oh, when I'm grown up, I'll know what I want, I'll be sorted. But you never really know what you want. You never feel grown up, not really, you never sort it all out. So I thought, I can handle life on my own. But after today, I don't want to.
Although the show was never quite my cup of tea, it's undeniable how much of an impact it made on young people, who have now grown up with an appreciation of the show more secure than perhaps Torchwood has enjoyed since both series have been off the air.
It's not so much the clowns' showbiz history that I'm interested in as their reputation for scaring people.
Their fear of the painted smile.
Russell T. Davis was now producing and writing for three tentpole BBC shows, and it's a wonder how long he managed to keep all those plates spinning. Back on the main series, Tennant's second year as the Doctor saw him gain a new companion in the form of Freema Agyeman's Martha Jones, a character who started with so much potential, being a trainee Doctor, and perhaps more of an intellectual equal to the Doctor.
Hold on. Doctor! We'll lose all the air.
But they're not exactly airtight. If the air was going to get sucked out, it would have happened straight away, but it didn't.
Very good point. Brilliant, in fact. What was your name?
Martha.
But who very quickly became a victim of the perceived need to inhabit the romantic partner role vacated by Rose.
When you say last time, was that You and Rose?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
You're taking me to the same planets that you took her.
What's wrong with that?
Nothing. Just ever heard the word rebound?
Her unrequited love for the Doctor and her deference to him as the heroic lead tends to diminish her character to the point where her off-screen solo adventuring career at the end of Series 3, when she allegedly travels a post-apocalyptic Earth spreading the word of the Doctor's magnificence while fending off the sadistic slaughter of the Toclophane, is barely credible.
I went across the continents all on my own. And everywhere I went, I found the people and I told them my story. He has saved your lives so many times and you never even knew he was there. I know him. I told them about the Doctor. I love him.
Saying that, however, I find Series 3 a far more enjoyable and consistently excellent affair than Tennant's first year, where missteps like Love and Monsters, with its Scooby-Doo slapstick comedy and questionable double entendres, or the lamentably cheesy Fear Her,
and no one wants to stop him, and it's more than a flame now, Bob, it's more than heat and light, it's hope, and it's courage, and it's love.
Bordered on the kind of absurd pantomime that the show was accused of in the late 80s. Series 3 saw the show confidently build on the strong foundation of its first 2 years, with stories that pushed the envelope further. We enjoyed journeys to the Elizabethan era for Gareth Roberts' Love Letter to Shakespeare, which enjoyed sublime production value by securing the actual Globe Theatre for location filming.
Special effects.
Your effect is special indeed.
It's not your best line.
The Daleks returned once more in a story set in Depression-era New York.
What the hell?
I have been summoned. Explain.
Convincingly realised with some shots captured by a skeleton crew on a quick transatlantic trip, and with the help of some car park walls that looked uncannily like the base of the Statue of Liberty.
Well, there's a genuine article. So good they named it twice. Mind you, it was New Amsterdam originally.
Stephen Moffat, pretty much firmly ensconced as a staff writer by this point, debuted what would become the standout monsters of the new series with his cost-cutting Dr. Light story, Blink, where companion who never was, Kerry Mulligan's Sally Sparrow, stared down the quantum-locked, time-feeding, weeping angels. Blink tends to take the top spot in most polls of the stories in this era, and whilst its excellence is undeniable, for me the real jewel in the crown of the 10th Doctor's second year has to be the two-parter Human Nature and the Family of Blood. Paul Coulnell, who had penned Series 1 tearjerker Father's Day, was one of that cohort of writers for whom Doctor Who had not only inspired careers, but had actually been their bread and butter in the past. Alongside the other writers commissioned to pen scripts for Series 3, such as Gareth Roberts and even Russell T. Davis himself, Coulnell had seen his literary forays into the Doctor Who universe in print during the wilderness years of the 90s. The most celebrated of his work was his new adventures novel Human Nature, frequently cited as the best instalment of that range. Once it was clear that Doctor Who had been firmly re-established as a Saturday night fixture, and realising the central conceit of that novel could lay the groundwork for Series 3's big finale, Davis invited Coulnell to adapt the classic for the programme proper. The story sees the leads in hiding at a boys' boarding school immediately prior to the First World War.
Who are you? Why can't I see you?
Why would you want to see us?
Pursued by the parasitic Family of Blood, who are in desperate need of the life force of a being with an extended lifespan, the Doctor makes use of a chameleon arch to rewrite his cellular structure into that of a human, hoping to avoid a confrontation where he might be forced to kill them before they naturally expire in 3 months.
But hold on, if you're going to rewrite every single cell, isn't it going to hurt?
Oh yeah. It hurt.
Motivated by his compassion, the Doctor therefore finds himself in the role of John Smith, a teacher at the boarding school, with an alternate history and personality, where his true persona only encroaches in dreams he tries to dismiss as fantasy and fancy.
I sometimes think how magical life would be if stories like this were true.
If only.
Or just a dream.
Don't know why he's so sweet on him.
He's just kind to me, that's all. Not everyone's that considerate, what with me being
a Londoner.
Exactly. Good old London town.
Now then, you two. Not paid to have fun, are you?
What I particularly like about this story is how the attitudes of the time are depicted in a way more honest and unflinching than in previous sojourns to the past in the modern series.
Hands like those, how can you tell when something's clean?
That's very funny, sir.
With Martha, as the only real hero left on the playing board after the Doctor's transformation, encountering a threefold disadvantage in being both working class, a woman, and black, creating an almost insurmountable obstacle in her efforts to ensure that the Doctor keeps a low profile and doesn't become too involved in the lives of the humans which surround them.
Well, I'd be careful. If you don't mind my saying, you sometimes seem a little familiar with him. Best remember your position. Yes, ma'am.
Tennant as John Smith, despite sporting a rather anachronistic hairstyle that would definitely have been commented on considering the time and his profession, is convincingly different from his incarnation of the Doctor, recognisably still a good man, but with the fervour to challenge injustice noticeably absent, especially in the scene where he unconcernedly gives permission for a boy to be beaten.
Permission to give Latimer a beating, sir.
It's not class, Mr. Smith.
Permission granted.
Right. Come with me, you little oik.
And his unthinking acceptance of the supposed duties to king and country expounded by a society who would soon after throw a generation of young men into the meat grinder that was the Western Front. This is carefully developed over the two episodes, however, where, once the family finally catch up with their prey, his true nature begins to impinge more overtly on his choices.
Martha was right about one thing, though, those boys, their children. John Smith wouldn't want them to fight. Never mind the Doctor. John Smith, I was getting to know. He knows it's wrong. Doesn't he?
Mr. Smith, if you please!
What choice do I have?
As they besiege the school with their animated scarecrow army, he is struck by epiphany whilst the children around him shoulder their rifles and pump a seemingly endless amount of deadly lead into their attackers. The scene, with its clever juxtaposition of the violence the children are fearfully enacting with the innocent sound of choral hymns on the soundtrack, acts as an effective allegory for what would happen to these boys the following year, ordered into the Valley of Death for a cause as questionable as protecting this single adult. Lowering his unfired rifle, it begins to dawn on John Smith exactly how morally necessary his sacrifice might be. Having discovered love and glimpsed a contented future he could never have as the Doctor, Smith's eventual surrender to his fate is tragic. Despite the sense of relief at having the Doctor back, outwitting the monsters in his usual flippant and inimitable way.
Oh, I think the explanation might be you've been fooled by a simple olfactory misdirection. A little bit like ventriloquism of the nose. It's an elementary trick in certain parts of the galaxy, but it has got to be said. I don't like the look of that hydroconometer.
The grief nurse Joan Redfern feels at having lost her lover is shared by the audience.
Answer me this, just one question, that's all. If the Doctor had never visited us, if it never chosen this place on a whim, would anyone here have died?
Making us sympathise somewhat with the Doctor's out-of-character revenge on the family, as he condemns each one to a fate worse than the death they so feared.
He wrapped my father in unbreakable chains forged in the heart of a dwarf star. He tricked my mother into the event horizon of a collapsing galaxy to be imprisoned there forever. He still visits my sister, once a year, every year. I wonder if one day he might forgive her, but there she is, can you see? He trapped her inside a mirror. Every mirror.
Indeed, our emotion in the moment blinds us somewhat to how cruel and unusual these punishments really are, and how they act as another indication of how the Tenth Doctor was beginning to revel in the power that he could wield.
As for me, I was suspended in time. And the Doctor put me to work, standing over the fields of England, as their protector. We wanted to live forever, so the Doctor made sure that we did.
More than this, though, the story is elevated by its grappling of real-world issues such as the morality of war and conscription, class discrimination, and the chauvinism of empire. Its Remembrance Day coda acting as a suitable tribute to the lost generation we have seen, warts and all, throughout the story.
At the going down of the sun, and in the morning, we will remember them.
As mentioned, the Chameleon Arch laid further groundwork for the finale, a trilogy of stories that reintroduced the Master and set the stakes the highest they'd been since the return.
Son, then who are you, Thor?
I am the Master.
After a fan-pleasing turn by Derek Jacobi as a Master similarly disguised on a cellular level, a regeneration into John Sim provided Tennant with a mirror image arch-nemesis.
Hello.
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 Anyway, why don't we stop and have a nice little chat while I tell you all my plans and you can work out a way to stop me.
I don't think.
Like the matching urbanity of the Pertwee and Delgado incarnations before them, Sim's unhinged master starts his reign of terror channeling the manic energy of Tennant to craft a silly yet psychopathic embodiment of evil.
I'm sorry.
Gone is the sophisticated, gentlemanly master criminal, and in his place, we have a literally hopping mad sadist positively delighting in his villainy.
End of the universe! Have fun! Bye-bye!
For me, however, the finale suffers from having to raise the stakes so high with a literal earthly apocalypse and a protagonist reduced to something akin to Dobby the House Elf that Davis writes himself into a corner, having to rely on an almost literal deus ex machina, with the Doctor returning to full vitality via the power of prayer and a reset button that conveniently erases the events of the final two episodes. This is where I feel that Davis's focus on character was sometimes at the expense of solid, dare I say even clever, ideas that would have resolved the plot more satisfactorily. If one looks past the inconsistencies and contradictions, there's a great story about the Doctor and the Master's relationship being explored with the same kind of complexity Davis had always brought to the show.
I've been alone ever since. But not anymore. Don't you see, all we've got is each other.
Are you asking me out on a date?
You could stop this right now. We could leave this planet. We could fight across the constellations if that's what you want, but not on Earth.
Too late.
But the mythic aspirations and pop culture conveniences results in an over-the-top conclusion that falls prey to the assumed need to be bigger and more explosive with every passing year. With the show now more successful than ever, a whole legion of new fans were eagerly exploring the history of the programme, embracing the classic era on DVD and the internet like never before, and encouraging the production team to be less fearful of likewise paying their respects to this until recently maligned legacy. The Children in Need special this year saw Peter Davison triumphantly return for a self-indulgent skit penned by Stephen Moffat, where fun was poked at the 80s incarnation, but nevertheless with good humour and affection.
Need this?
No, I'm fine.
Oh no, of course. You must have went hands-free, didn't you? Like, hey, I'm the Doctor, I can save the universe using a kettle and some string. And look at me, I'm wearing a vegetable.
After the Daleks, Cybermen and Master, the next returning villain was decided to be the Sontarans, an enemy far less prominent in the memories of the general audience, and evidence that the team now felt more confident in resurrecting further artifacts from the history of the programme.
This isn't war! This is sport!
Christmas Day saw the series' highest viewing figures since 1979, as almost 14 million viewers tuned in to enjoy a bumper-length, festive instalment, with international pop sensation Kylie Minogue in the role of ill-fated almost-companion Astrid Peth, alongside Tennant on board the spaceship Titanic, another story that depicted the Doctor in an almost messianic role as was starting to become routine. Following this, Tennant returned for his third year as the Doctor, and in my opinion, his strongest. After Martha's departure at the end of Series 3, Davis knew that it was time for a companion who wasn't going to be merely pining after the lead for 13 stories, reciprocated or not. Most of us had by now come to terms with this incarnation's proclivity to snog every young female left, right and centre since his first trip off-world, but that didn't make it less annoying at times. I think what irked about this was less the failure to strictly adhere to what had been the character's asexuality, and more that it somehow made him less unique, less obviously motivated by his desires and personal gratification. This is, after all, what marked the character as unique amongst many other male heroes in adventure fiction. Fortunately, Davis envisioned a different dynamic for Series 4, crafting a character called Penny, a more mature woman recently split from her cheating partner, with a loss of direction in life, who eagerly takes on the mantle of interstellar hero alongside the seemingly younger Doctor. As the scripts for the series were developed, it dawned on Davis that he was essentially recalling the character of Donna Noble, the one-off companion of Tennant's second Christmas special, The Runaway Bride. Incredibly successful comedian Catherine Tate's turn as the irreverent, sarcastic Donna had proven a success, proving naysayers wrong with her ability to also play the deeper aspects of her personality, displaying a vulnerability and compassion that detractors thought a performer of light entertainment wouldn't be able to pull off convincingly.
Doctor! Blimey, you can shout!
Am I ever going to see you again?
If I'm lucky.
Just... promise me one thing. Find someone.
I don't need anyone.
Yes, you do. Because sometimes I think you need someone to stop you.
Yeah.
Fortunately, Tate had loved playing the role, and after careful negotiations taking into account her busy schedule, Davis was delighted to welcome her back to play Donna Noble full-time for the whole series. The relationship between the Doctor and Donna is arguably far stronger and more entertaining than the one he had shared with Martha, despite it being overshadowed several times by cameos of Billy Piper, setting up the finale and the inevitable reunion with Rose.
I just want a mate.
You just want to mate?
I just want a mate.
You're not mating with me, Sunshine.
A mate. I want a mate.
Well, just as well, because I'm not having any of that nonsense. I mean, you're just a long streak of nothing. You know, alien nothing.
There we are, then. Okay.
I can come.
Yeah. Of course you can, yeah. I love it.
After the sweet and slapstick opening episode, Donna's following adventures helped to develop her character immensely, seeing her tangle with the moral and ethical dilemmas of travelling with the Doctor in ways that helped to convincingly establish her compassionate and selfless nature beneath the apparently sardonic and snide exterior.
How many people died?
Stop it!
Doctor! How many people died?
20,000.
Is that what you can see, Doctor? All 20,000? And you think that's all right, do you?
As with each of the series since the revival, there are many excellent and superb stories in Series 4, which effectively demonstrate the range and versatility of the programme at its best. Whether it's the Roman romp that becomes a powerful consideration of the Doctor's responsibilities in the fires of Pompeii.
Your own planet.
That's just it. Don't you see, Donna? Can't you understand? If I could go back and save them, then I would, but I can't. I can never go back. I can't. I just can't. I can't.
Just someone. Please. Not the whole town. Just save someone.
The emotional exploration of slavery in Planet of the Ood.
The Ood were nothing without us, just animals roaming around on the ice.
That's because you can't hear them.
They welcomed it. It's not as if they put up a fight.
You idiot. They're born with their brains in their hands, don't you see? That makes them peaceful. They've got to be, because a creature like that would have to trust anyone it meets.
Oh, nice one.
Thank you.
The comedic pastiche of the tropes of whodunits in The Unicorn and the Wasp.
I've called you here on this endless night, because we have a murderer in our midst.
Or the claustrophobic psychological horror of Midnight.
Sky.
Sky?
Are you all right?
Are you all right?
Are you hurt?
Are you hurt?
You don't have to talk.
You don't have to talk.
I'm trying to help.
I'm trying to help.
There are classics aplenty to choose from that ably demonstrate how experienced, confident, and ambitious the production team had become since 2005. As always, choosing a favourite feels like denying the brilliance of these other efforts, but for me the two-parter Silence in the Library and The Forest of the Dead stand head and shoulders above the rest, not least for how significant it would become for the future of the series. By the time it was transmitted at the end of May 2008, Russell T. Davies had already announced that he would be stepping down as the showrunner of Doctor Who after the completion of Series 4, and that Stephen Moffat would be taking on the mantle. Having had his nose to the grindstone since 2004, and having taken on substantial responsibilities for three flagship programmes since then, Davis's health was undeniably suffering, and he knew it was time to move on. His departure wouldn't be for a while, however, to provide the new production team with a suitable amount of time to prepare for their first series, and a stint with the Royal Shakespeare Company meant that Tennant would be starring in special episodes throughout 2009 instead of a full series. This meant that the production of Series 4 would be extended to throughout the year following its ostensible conclusion. With Davis's departure after so successfully steering the ship through the tumultuous waters of the first few years, I shared some of the concerns that others had for the future of the programme. Following the outstanding quality of Moffat's previous scripts, however, I was very excited to see how his inventiveness and Robert Holmes-inspired grasp of fairytale gothic scariness might take the show in a direction that aligned even more closely with what I enjoyed about the programme. Silence in the Library, therefore, was scrutinised a little more closely for what might be a clear sign of things to come.
So, we weren't just in the neighbourhood.
Yeah, I kind of sort of lied a bit. I got a message on the psychic paper. What do you think? Cry for help?
Cry for help with a kiss.
Mysteriously summoned to the library, a vast planet-sized archive of all recorded literature, the Doctor and Donna are curious as to its apparent emptiness before encountering the space-suited members of an archaeological expedition funded by the Thalman Lux Corporation, intent on discovering the fate of the thousands of people who went missing when the library was sealed 100 years before.
Please just leave. I'm asking you seriously and properly. Just leave. Hang on. Did you say expedition?
My expedition. I funded it.
Oh, you're not, are you? Tell me you're not archaeologists.
Meanwhile, the time traveller's explorations are intercut with the seemingly normal present-day life of a young girl receiving psychiatric therapy who appears to dream the fantastical events involving the Doctor.
When you close your eyes...
I go to the library.
Go to the library now.
Most significantly, this story sees the introduction of River Song, a character who would become so integral to the convoluted timey-wimey narrative arcs of the coming Moffat era.
Hello, sweetie. You're doing a very good job acting like you don't know me. I'm assuming there's reason.
A fairly good one, isn't it?
Okay, should we do diaries then? Where are we this time?
Partly inspired by the New Adventures novel companion Bernice Summerfield, River makes an immediate impact on the meta-narrative of the show, like a boulder dropped in a lake, by apparently being a later companion of the Doctor who is intimately aware of his future, whilst being a stranger to the Doctor himself by virtue of their meeting out of chronological order.
Have we done Asgard yet? Obviously not. Blimey, very early days then. Whew, life of the time traveller, never knew it could be such hard work.
It's an idea so strong, building on the effectively Ouroboric DVD Easter egg conversation of Moffat's earlier blink, it's a wonder that the show had not really done it before. But then, ironically for a show with time travel at its heart, Doctor Who had shied from the complexity of temporal linearities for much of its history, leaving fertile, mostly unexplored soil on which Moffat could tread.
You've seen me before then?
Doctor... Please tell me you know who I am.
Who are you?
The cleverness of having this, the Doctor's first meeting of her, be, from her point of view, her final adventure with him, encouraged many excited discussions and theories as to the mystery of their future relationship.
It's okay. It's okay. It's not over for you. You'll see me again. You've got all of that to come. You and me. Time and space. You watch us run.
River, you know my name.
Auto-destruct.
You whispered my name in my ear.
9, 8, 7.
There's only one reason I would ever tell anyone my name.
5.
There's only one time I could.
Of course, anyone who had read The Time Traveller's Wife likely had quite a clear idea of how the story would eventuate, but nevertheless, Moffat's teasing of the complexities of an overarching narrative, wedded with familiar childlike terrors such as parasitic shadows, the repetition of seemingly innocuous phrases in a sinister context.
Hey, who turned out the lights?
Hey, who turned out the lights?
Doctor, don't.
Dave, can you hear me?
Hey, who turned out the lights?
And the twist denouement where, after all seems resolved somewhat tragically, the Doctor manages to save the day one final time.
Why? Why would I give him my screwdriver? Why would I do that? Thing is, future me, she has to think about it. Although she has to think of a way to save her. And what he did was give her a screwdriver. Why would I do that? Oh. Look at that. I'm very good.
What have you done?
Saved her.
All clearly indicate the sandbox in which the new head writer would play for the next few years.
We are the dead of the library.
Well, what about the children? The children aren't dead. My children aren't dead.
Your children were never alive.
Don't you say that. Don't you dare say that about my children.
Look at your children. Look at all of them, really look. They're not real. Do you see it now? They're all the same.
Personally, I found Donna slowly becoming aware of the illusory nature of the domestic bliss provided for her inside the library's computer matrix, desperately holding on to the existence of her ephemeral children until a single blink wipes them, tragic and more existentially moving than the soap opera unrequited love stories of Rose and Martha, and I was hopeful for more in the same vein when Moffat eventually took up the reins.
But Mummy, sometimes when you're not here, it's like we're not here.
Even when you close your eyes, we just stop.
Well, Mummy promises to never close our eyes again.
By this stage, the production triumvirate of Davis, Phil Collinson and Julie Gardner was slowly breaking up, with Collinson departing for BBC Manchester at the end of Series 4, Gardner beginning the handover of her responsibilities to incoming Series 5 producer Piers Wenger, and Davis working on what would become 5 special episodes, including 2 Christmas editions. Tennant had originally signed a contract for 3 years as the Doctor, and with his third series in the can, having once again faced down the threat of Dalek-orchestrated Armageddon with the help of no fewer than all his fully-fledged new series companions, plus further assistance from the various characters introduced in the spin-off series, expending a regeneration and spawning a human clone of himself in the process, the actor was considering his future with the show. He had lived the dream, becoming the modern-day equivalent of the formerly unsurpassable Tom Baker in the minds of millions at home and abroad, but now he had to ask himself whether it was time to wake up. Doctor Who had been more than just another job for him. He'd even met his future wife, Georgia Moffat, when she'd appeared as the Doctor's pseudo-daughter in Series 4. In suitably timey-wimey weirdness, she is now both a Doctor's wife, as well as literally a Doctor's daughter, her father being 5th Doctor Peter Davison. Tennant's past, present and future were indelibly entwined with the programme, but as an ambitious actor whose success now spawned opportunities beyond his prior dreams, it seemed the time was right to move on before it was too late. Initially, the impending end of the Davis era decided for him, and he felt it seemed right to leave as the showrunner did, making way for a new Doctor for the incoming production team to craft as their own. Discussions with Moffat about his ideas for Series 5 tempted him to stay, however, the 3-time Hugo Award-winning writer giving him tantalising hints about his plans for his first year as showrunner. But after much reflection, Tennant decided against continuing beyond the 5 specials, and in a daring bit of cloak-and-dagger negotiations, the actor announced his impending departure whilst accepting an award for outstanding drama performance via a live video link during an interval of that night's staging of Hamlet in Stratford-upon-Avon.
But when Doctor Who returns in 2010, it won't be with me.
Audiences were shocked and upset at the news, but speculation was immediately rife as to how the 10th Doctor would meet his fate, and who it would be taking on the role of the next incarnation. As had become de rigueur for the series since its return, an impending explosive finale was not something to be ignored until it eventually came about, and the subsequent specials shown at key dates during 2009 signposted the coming conclusion of the Tennant era with teasing premonitions and a sense of impending dread.
What do you mean?
It is returning. It is returning through the dark. And then, Doctor... Oh, but then... He will knock 4 times.
The knock four times seemed pretty clear to those of us who had been paying attention for the last few years, but the vault farce of the Doctor's unbridled hubris as he decides to play at being God in the closing moments of the Waters of Mars came as an unexpected surprise.
But you said we die! For the future, for the human race!
Yes, because there are laws. There are laws of time. And once upon a time, there were people in charge of those laws, but they died. They all died. Do you know who that leaves? Me! It's taken me all these years to realise the laws of time are mine, and they will obey me!
On reflection, it shouldn't have done. The Tennant era is marked by examples of the Doctor being tempted into megalomaniacal acts as early as his debut, but I never expected Davis to tip him so far over the line into truly irresponsible abandon.
The whole of history could change. The future of the human race. No one should have that much power.
Tough.
You should have left us there.
Adelaide, I've done this sort of thing before. In small ways, say some little people. But never someone as important as you. Oh, I'm good.
Little people? What, like Mia and Yuri? Who decides they're so unimportant? You?
For a long time now, I thought I was just a survivor, but I'm not. I'm the winner. That's who I am. The Time Lord victorious.
And there's no one to stop you.
No.
The consequences of his arrogance are immediately brought home to him with the shocking suicide of Adelaide Brooke in order to preserve the timeline corrupted by the Doctor's vainglorious acts. Knowing that he has stepped over the line, the Doctor runs from a fateful judgment for his crime, unwilling to suffer the consequences he knows are coming. It's a moment of weakness and callousness from a previously unimpeachable hero, almost making him the villain of the piece, besides the force of nature that is the terrifying Flood and the laws of time previously upheld by the Time Lords. It was a brave decision to make the audience almost wish for his comeuppance, an incarnation who had become the epitome of heroism for so many, and it's a shame that this isn't developed further in the following two-part finale beyond some regretful recollections, the need for him to occupy his traditional role too necessary for the sacrifice he must make to come about. This fertile ground for further adventures was something left to be picked up by later writers and the recent multimedia Time Lord Victoria story arc.
No.
It is said that in the final days of planet Earth, everyone had bad dreams.
The End of Time, Tennant's final story as the Doctor, is a celebration of the five-year Davis era, with all the epic scale, emotional weight, and mythic aspirations that had come to define his stories. It sees fan favourite Wilfred Mott return, portrayed by National Treasure Bernard Cribbins, this time as a fully-fledged companion, if only for these two instalments.
Each and every one of those people had dreamt of the terrible things to come. But they forgot, because they must. They forgot their nightmares of fire and war and insanity. They forgot, except for one.
A resurrected master played with even more unhinged gusto by John Sim also returns to wreak havoc across the Earth.
He can smell me. Can't let him smell me. Doctor, stop the smell. The stink, filthy.
Before the true villains of the piece are unveiled, the narrator of the story up to this point revealing himself as wartime Time Lord President Rassilon, plotting an escape for Gallifrey from the last day of the fabled Time War, with plans for universal annihilation and ascension to actual godhood.
For Gallifrey!
For Gallifrey!
For victory!
For victory!
For the end of time itself!
For the end!
The stakes have never been higher, as the Doctor faces seemingly insurmountable odds, wielding a weapon he had previously sworn never to use with a sort of determined yet impotent rage against the dying of the light.
Get out of the way.
Thank you.
is broken! Back into the Time War, Rassilon! Back into hell!
Get out of the way.
And then a seeming reprieve as the Master finally fights beside him, helping to cast the Time Lords back into the time-locked hell from whence they have come. However, in true Davis fashion, the conclusion of the Greater Peril brings only a realization of the true fate for the characters, as it is revealed that Wilf can only be saved from inevitable death by the Doctor's ultimate sacrifice. It's a touching moment, but I've always considered the Doctor's tantrum upon recognizing what is necessary rather unfortunate.
Oh, really? Just leave me. I'm an old man, Doctor. I've had my time.
Well, exactly. Look at you. Not remotely important. But me? I could do so much more! So much more! But this is what I get. My reward. But it's not fair!
It's relatable, yes, and he clearly overcomes this moment of weakness and temptation. But this adolescent anger diminishes his sacrifice somewhat, I would argue, and makes his
Wilfred, it's my honour,
a little less credible, coming straight after an outburst which doesn't really reflect the maturity we'd come to expect from a character who had previously made similar sacrifices. The following montage, where his reward of visiting all his companions, righting wrongs and tying up the relationships in neat bows, whilst moving and rewarding for long-time viewers, is also a little too self-indulgent for my taste, undermining his sacrifice further as it seems to provide him with a very extended death. The third and fifth Doctors had also endured slow demises, likewise giving them the opportunity for farewells, but in both cases their decline was far more visible and deleterious, increasing tension rather than dissipating it in the desire for a roller coaster ride through respective emotional moments. Perhaps, had the tenth Doctor visibly begun to deteriorate beyond a few stumbles here and there, it would have worked more effectively. This is not to say that he should slowly have fallen apart like a zombie, but that some physical decline like Pertwee or Davison had would have indicated more explicitly that he was indeed living on borrowed time.
It's him! It's the Doctor!
Considering that Davis had already sort of touched upon this notion of farewell in the Series 4 finale Journey's End, with its enormous roster of guest stars acting as a celebration of his and their contributions to the three series, I feel it might have been better had the Doctor merely used the time left to make the final trip, where he encounters Rose on the New Year's Eve before his previous incarnation first met her, and shares a brief and touching farewell with her before stumbling back to his only really constant friend as the snow falls.
I bet you're gonna have a really great year.
Yeah? See ya.
As his hands finally begin to show the signs of his coming regeneration, the final line of this arguably most conceited incarnation is a tear-jerking,
"I don't want to go."
In these words, we hear not the Doctor so much as a writer and producer who had successfully resurrected a mythos thought dead by so many, and an actor whose inhabitation of the character was a lifelong dream, both facing the decision made by a head over the wishes of a heart. Just like that, the dream was over, and what a dream it had been. But you know the great thing about dreams? They can be shared, they can be passed on, and in doing so, they can be reborn.